tractor. Okay, so you get evolutionary change by changing the initial conditions of development. The second opportunity is that you change the strength of these interactions, and that changes smoothly the position of the attractor. So the attractors move, but you don't get any sort of big qualitative changes. There will just be a little less of the green factor than before. You can have, if you change this, the symmetry of these interactions, you can change the position of the separatrix, and suddenly if you start here, you fall into a different basin of attraction. And lastly, you can have bifurcations, just that, like I showed you before, you have a new attractor state and you get something completely new. Now, if you think about it carefully, these three are completely discrete, okay? So if you believe in Darwinian gradualism in evolution, only this is allowed here. What this diagram shows you is a very simple argument that if you evolve networks to the diversity of different regulatory networks that we have nowadays, Darwinian gradualism cannot apply, simply. This is a principled argument that these sort of events must have happened during evolution, so non-gradual transitions must be happening all the time. And instead of sort of saying we have a theory that doesn't allow them, so they don't happen, we should adjust the theory to reality and say we should have a theory that incorporates what happens when such events occur. Okay? All right, so the last third of my talk, I will just give you an example, a real world example of what we've actually done with this. Are you still okay? Everybody's still on board. So let's go back to the segmentation genes. And I want to show you the full system. So this, first of all, this little pair of interacting genes that I was showing you before is just a small part of a big hierarchy. What you see here is the first 3 hours of Drosophila development is a very fast developing embryo. If you think about this, these nuclei, they divide every 12 minutes in the beginning of development. This is the fastest cell division I know of on Earth. I don't know any bacterium. Mind you that this organism has a genome 10 to 50 times the size of a bacterium. It's huge. And it needs to replicate the genome. So this system is on autopilot. It is growing in a rotting fruit. It needs to get out quickly. Okay? So it's been adapted for really fast growth. 3 hours, you see that the nuclei divide here is an earlier embryo with fewer nuclei. But again, like in the picture before, this is the head, this is the tail. And the mother has loaded the embryo with factors, RNAs, bicuit RNA, for example, here, that produces a protein that then diffuses through this syncytial embryo. Remember, it's just one big cell. And it makes this beautiful concentration gradient here. There are 2 more of these maternal coordinate factors. They instruct the zygotic gap genes, which are expressed from the embryo's genome, and they are expressed in these overlapping discrete regions I was showing you before. They interact among each other. So you have a set of, Hunchback is here twice, so you have a set of 7 genes that are important for this patterning system. It's not so easy anymore to just look at it and understand it. And then these transcription factors instruct this beautiful pattern of the peril genes. So here you have the first time a periodic pattern, 7 stripes that then double. What happened here is that the embryo wrapped around the eggshell. Here is the tail end now. And you have 14 beautiful molecular stripes that, of gene expression that prefigure the morphological segmentation of the body. Okay. The proposal for my PhD was that I wrote 18 years ago was to sort of model this whole cascade, and we're still here today. So much for your PhD proposal. If there's PhD students here, it's not always as easy as you think. But you know, we've made some progress. And just like the sort of reverse engineering that we've done before by just looking at it, what we do is now we take a little bit of math, we measure these expression patterns over time, we quantify them. So we take the axis here and we measure the concentration of these factors, different time classes, and we formulate this a very simple model of the gene network with now these 4 genes and the 3 maternal inputs that we have. This is the only equation I'm going to show you, but it's sort of just to illustrate that we have a dynamical system. This term here describes the change in the concentration of each of the gene products in the gap gene system over time in each nucleus. And it depends on three factors. One is protein decay, so the protein that's produced is decaying at a rate proportional to the amount of protein that is there. It's not very interesting. There's diffusion because there's no membranes. This is a standard Fickian diffusion term. It's completely uninteresting again. And then all the interesting stuff is happening here. You have two big summation signs that get all the inputs from other genes into this sort of function, which is an expression, a regulation expression function, which means that if you have a lot of activators, the gene will be fully on, but it saturates at some point, the rate of production of protein. And if you have a lot of repressors, it'll be off. Okay, so this is a nonlinear system of equations. It's hard to predict how it works. These two W and E terms encode a matrix of factors. And if you look at this, let's pick out this regulatory parameter here. Regulators are columns, targets are rows. This number here gives you the influence of regulator number 2 on target number 1. Okay? It can be positive, so it's an activation, it switches the other gene on. It can be a repression, it switches the other gene on. Or it can be 0, it doesn't do anything. So this matrix encodes this sort of network I was showing you before. Okay. And what we can do now is we can take a random set of numbers, solve it, and compare the output of the model to the data. The random parameters will make a random pattern. Okay. Then we mutate one of the parameters, we compare again. And you use an evolutionary algorithm, you literally evolve the system in the computer until the model gives you exactly the pattern of the data. So you fit the model to the data. You then go back and you look at the parameters and you have a network and also a face portrait of the system that produces the pattern that you see. So you use mathematical modeling here not to predict anything, but to understand something. So you use it to extract a regulatory network from the data that you have. Is that clear? That's sort of an unusual way of using a model. So you use it as an empirical tool to express, to extract regulatory information from the data. Okay. The algorithm we're using here, the most efficient one is depressingly a sort of a targeted evolution. It's called scatter search. It's sort of a creationist version of evolution because it has a very sort of taboo, it visits areas of parameter regions in a very targeted way, plus you get some selection and it works wonderfully. I don't use this to advertise any sort of guided evolution arguments, but if you want to fit models to data, that works. Okay. I don't want to draw any sort of biological conclusions from that. Okay, so we've done this. I did this during my PhD. We took this model and we fit it to this beautiful data set here. You can just see a time series example of fly embryos again, and you can see the early patterns. This is hunchback. So here you have Krupel and Giant again, the couple of genes we looked at before. Early patterns in the early blastoderm stage, which is the relevant stage of development, and then the late stage, and you have these sort of moving peaks of these expression domains here, and this is the area of the expression domain. So you get this sort of accordion movement. The domains move to the anterior over time, and they narrow, they become sharper and more precise. And the model reproduces this behavior exactly, which is really nice, and was kind of unexpected. So we can now study how this pattern comes about. And the model gives us, just to say that's important for what I'm going to tell you in 5 minutes, that you can do this with much less beautiful, but also much less labor-intensive data sets. You just stain for the RNA, uglier sort of protocol, but all you need to know is when and where the genes are switched on or off, okay? And it works. So what you get is this sort of version of my, you know, the graph I was showing you before, the Davidson graph, is called a hairball graph. This is my own hairball. It's something like that an eagle would puke out after he's eaten the mouse, the hair of the mouse, and it's very very good depiction. And the difference between this and Davidson's diagram is that I can tell you exactly what each one of the interactions does. Let me explain this diagram to you. So it has a spatial component. This is the head, this is the tail region of the embryo. The background color is the maternal gradients that you saw before in the picture. And then the boxes show you where, you know, green and the blue gene again are expressed. Here, strong negative interaction, you have a second pair out like this. You have some, in the back of the embryo, you have some more genes that are important, forget about them. And then you have this sort of weird interactions between overlapping gap genes, very weak repressive interactions. And the model tells us that this is what causes this accordion sort of movement. The interesting thing about this is that A, you cannot study this using genetics because there is no mutant that specifically affects this accordion movement of the domains. Because this accordion movement is an emergent property of all the interactions, so the interactions will only produce this effect if a very specific constellation of interactions exists in this network. So without mathematical modeling, you cannot understand this phenomenon. One of the reviewers said this is not important because it's very subtle, which is an interesting argument in biology. And we replied, this is important, it means our methods are very good because we detect it. But I don't understand this argument that if something is a small effect, it's not important. But there we go. So these shifts, the domains shift around, but nothing is actually moving through the embryo. So I need to very briefly talk to you. Do you have any time left, actually? Should I wrap up already? Or?
You're supposed to have 2 minutes left.
2 minutes. I can do three. I'm almost
perfectly
there.
Fine.
So these shifts, nothing moves. So what's actually happening is that they're kinematic shifts. They're like a Mexican wave in a soccer stadium. So it's people stay put, but they raise their hands, and the wave moves through the stadium. Nobody moves around the stadium. And this is exactly what's happening here. You have different nuclei, which are represented by these columns. They have different initial states, represented by the yellow shading here. And they go through different... So this one expresses first Krupel and then Knerps. Knerps and then giant. And if you squint, you can see how the domain of Knerps, the red domain here, is moving through the tissue, apparently, although nothing is really moving, right? And the mechanism that is driving this, and this is, thank you, PowerPoint, very pixelated here, is that each nucleus moves through a sort of a color wheel clock at a different sort of quarter of an hour. It's a very bad clock, it never repeats. It just goes through a quarter of an hour, and each nucleus goes through a different quarter of an hour on the clock. But what's driving this is a clock. It's a damped oscillator, okay? This is a very, very difficult, this is just the definition, the mathematical definition of an oscillator. Nothing oscillates, nothing repeats. But the underlying mechanism is still an oscillator, it's just very damped. So it's in a very damped limit. It's like a clock that is never able to finish one complete hour. Okay. So to summarize this part, we have a surprising insight. Although these patterns look very much the same in the anterior and the posterior of the embryo, I didn't tell you that, but in the anterior, the domains don't move. And you have switches, just like the toggle switches I was showing you before. So what I'm showing you here is just a three-dimensional version of this face portrait where nuclei fall into different basins of attraction. While in the posterior, you have this weird color wheel clock. Completely, qualitatively different mechanisms, just to drive that home. This is sort of a metaphor for the switch attractor system. If you have kids, you know, you put them in. Where they end up, it's pretty much determined at the top, unless they are a little anarchist, like when they have a home jump lane in the middle. And this is the classic damped oscillator. If you don't push them, they will stop, right? And where they will stop will determine in the end where the pattern ends up. But you certainly wouldn't disagree that these are qualitatively very different situations. Although the differences in the pattern are quite subtle. Okay, so let me just kind of sort of pull that together and bring it back to the network. So we were trying to figure out how is that mapping back onto these network interactions. We did all kinds of fancy, we took this network and tried to cut it up, paper and scissors, into different units that do different things. It didn't work. So then we looked at the spatial distribution of these gap genes and did something very simple. So if you look at the anterior, the middle, and the posterior of the embryo, you see that there's always only three gap gene products present, which I'm highlighting here. And there are different genes in different regions, but if you look at their interactions, what do you notice? They're all wired in the same way. They're wired. They're all AC-DC circuits. Okay, and I was telling you very much at the beginning, this is the circuit that can do oscillations, and switches, okay? And all you need to do is change the strength of the interactions a little bit to get from one very different behavior to another. So you need very little genetic change to get a completely different behavior, and that's just summarized here, but that's important because you can explain the static domain boundaries in the anterior through switches, the shifting domain boundaries in the posterior through the damped oscillator, and then, and I didn't have time to talk about this, but this system evolved from an oscillator, an oscillating system that adds segments as the embryo grows. Just you push the system a little bit further and you get an oscillator that actually repeats. Okay? So the take-home message from this is that the changes you require for the evolution of the system, patterning system that we see in Drosophila, are surprisingly small to create these really big changes that you observe in the dynamics of the genes. Oh, I forgot about this. If I have two more minutes, I'll give you just a bit of comparative insight. So this was all about Drosophila. I want to just move out of Drosophila a little bit more to make clear how this is important for evolution. This is just my advertisement flies flies are actually worth studying and really beautiful in themselves, not just look at them. This is a blowfly. They're disgusting. So if they wouldn't exist, the whole of Earth would be covered with dead bodies. They're very important for decay. This, if you're from California, is Ceratitis, the actual fruit fly. Drosophilas are not fruit flies, they're vinegar flies. This is a fruit pest, the med fly, that's a huge problem in California. Mosquitoes, tiger mosquitoes, you have them here, they're really annoying. And dangerous. Beautiful horse fly. They really hurt when they bite you, but look at it, it's beautiful. Robber flies, this one is a stalk-eyed fly. I don't know what evolution thought about this. So you have to think that these are, they're flying, right? I mean, they must get seasick when they fly. I don't know how they, so the stalk eyes are, the eyes are on the top of the stalks and they're used for mating and also ritual flights. Moth midges are what we work in the lab. This is a hoverfly, beautifully camouflaged. I shouldn't get distracted too much, because I just wanted to show you a comparison between Drosophila and this fly, Megazilia, that we kept in the lab. There's 180 million years between those two flies and what I'm showing you here. Don't worry about the other flies at the moment. So this is a phylogenetic tree that shows you that Diptera are divided into mosquitoes, one big branch here that I'm not highlighting, and then the unfortunately named higher flies, or Saccharaphon flies up here. I don't know what makes them higher than other flies, but this is a common mistake in phylogeny. And what you see here are the maternal gradients, I wasn't really talking about them, and the gap gene patterns here. What I want you to notice is a simple thing. Within this red group, the gap genes are expressed in exactly the same spatial pattern, while the inputs to the system are changing considerably. So each one of these different flies is missing one of the gradients in Drosophila. So how can the system compensate for this really big sort of changes in maternal inputs? And what we did is exactly the same as in Drosophila. We got some quantitative data. I'm summarizing 10 years of work in a slide. Fit model to the data and then compare the different models. And we also did some experimental work, knocking down, I don't want to go into detail, the different genes and figuring out the interactions. Just like that work that led to the sea urchin diagram before and after. About 6 years of work, we found out that the network in Megazilia and this other fly is exactly the same network as in Drosophila, which was first, it was a bit frustrating, especially to the postdoc who had 6 years of, invested 6 years of his life into this. But then we found something interesting, that the strength of the interactions actually changed in evolution. And I think this is sort of the standard mode of evolution of regulatory networks. It's the most likely thing to happen if you have molecular changes, is that it affects the strength, not necessarily the nature of the interaction. And we did modeling in this fly. The take-home message here is that what's happening is that when you change the strength of these interactions, the area where domains move versus the area where domains are stable changes. And so in this early branching lineages, a lot more of the embryo moves than in Drosophila. And so the idea is that if you come from the original oscillator-like mechanism, evolution has a really easy time playing with this, the extent of this area. And what the function is of this in evolution is to compensate for changing. So the maternal inputs constantly change, and changes in these interactions, they compensate for those changes in the maternal inputs. I went over this very quickly, but this is basically a neutral mode of evolution. It's called developmental system drift. And what we've done here for the first time is we've come up with a molecular mechanism that explains how an evolving system can compensate, maintain the same pattern under very different inputs, sort of circumstances. So to wrap up and to come back to Waddington, and this is really the end of it, I would like to intersect a layer into the genotype phenotype map, and that layer is Waddington's epigenotype here in the middle, and that is the sort of dynamical behavior of the system, the face portraits of the system that live in between. So if you want to understand this sort of bridge between the genotype and the phenotype, you need to do dynamical modeling, you need to do these face portraits, and you need to compare them to each other. And in this way you understand what kind of patterns are actually possible, what patterns are not, what transitions are likely phenotypically and what are not, and which kind of different mechanisms, different networks produce the same patterning outcome and which ones do not. This is important, and this is a neglected layer between these two different layers that are studied very intensively. And this is really not going to work, but I'm just going to skip it because maybe I'll just wrap up. What evolutionary developmental biology is trying to do is trying to understand how you change the system while keeping it working. That's actually the most fascinating aspect of evolution, is you have to change the system while it keeps on working. And Brett Cowcott has this very interesting philosophical interpretation of how developmental evolution differs from normal evolutionary explanations. So what we're trying to do is find historical chains for how you get from one bird. This is my voice came up with this version. It's very easy to do in the English language with four letters. It gets increasingly difficult with a higher number of letters, but it's sort of very easy to evolve systems through this sort of neutral network. So you have to have functional, you have to have continuity. Only one letter can be changed at a time, and you have to maintain productivity at the same time. And if we can come up with a series like this, figuratively, of course, for segmentation evolution, that's a very important contribution to evolutionary biology, although it is not an explanation at the population level of how alleles and frequencies and genes change in a population. This is the product of 15 years of work. I just want to point out very few people here. First of all, my group in Barcelona, Carl and Eva did the experiments, Anton did the model fitting, Damian was the programmer, and Berta did the mathematical work on this. Hilda created a few mutants to test our results. I want to acknowledge John Reinitz and David Sharp, who came up with this crazy idea of reverse engineering gene networks in the late 80s, when it wasn't extremely popular or thought to be feasible yet. I have to mention Michael Aiken, who let me do this evolutionary work in his lab in Cambridge, although it had no chance of sort of success at the time. And Urschmidt Ock, who helped me with the flies that we were working with. Do not ever trust this man when he says it's easy to work with an animal that is not well established in the lab. I would like to acknowledge a bunch of people that are now carrying this work forward with me. Berta is now at Cambridge, James is still at the KLI, Nick is my mathematical collaborator, and Manfred and Werner have thought about the nature of explanations in EvoDevo. I'm currently at the Complexity Science Hub in Vienna and spend four wonderful ones at the Center for Systems Biology in Dresden. And with that, I'll stop and take your questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.